Good morning, church. We believe God is present in this room, not just because we meet in a building called a church or because there's a cross hanging in a couple places, but because we gather as his people. He inhabits not only our hearts, for those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ, he inhabits the praises of his people, as scripture teaches us. So we come this morning before a holy God, the most important appointment of our week, to meet with him and to worship with him and to hear his word. I invite you to stand and we'll sing together.
O sovereign God, O matchless King, the saints adore, the angels sing and fall before the throne of grace. Belongs the highest praise. These sufferings, this passing tide, under your wings I will abide, and every enemy shall flee. You are my hope and praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, clothed in power and in grace, the name above all other names. To the valley for my soul, your great descent has made me whole. Your word my heart has welcomed home. Now peace like water ever flows. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, clothed in
I'm strong. Well, good morning. Please have a seat. As the church gathers, if you are our guest this morning, if you're a visitor with us, I encourage you to fill out a communication card that's in the seat back in front of you. You can use that for anything, to communicate to the office, a prayer request, or change of address, or anything like that. We encourage you to do that. Welcome this morning. We have a couple of special guests with us this morning. Come on up. Dr. George and Val Schultz are with us, have been part of Riverwood for a long time, although not here very often. Tell us where you've been the last 25 or so years, George.
Good morning, everyone. We're happy to have a chance to worship the Lord with you this morning. We have been serving in Cameroon, which is in Central Africa, for about 27 years, and what we've been doing there is Bible translation work. Three different main things we've been doing. One, working with the Kom language community to help them to translate this, the Kom New Testament, into their language. They didn't have a written language when we first arrived there, so we helped them to develop their language and help them to translate the scriptures. Then I was asked to be the field director. So we directed the work of Bible translation in that part of the world for about 8 years. And then more recently, the last 7 years, we've been training Cameroonian Bible translators in partnership with a theological seminary in Cameroon, preparing them to translate the Bible into their own languages.
Expound on that a little bit, just the significance of I mean, we're all familiar with Bible translation and that, but the significance of training Cameroonians to do the work themselves, how that multiplies it, the significance of that.
Well, we felt led that more and more Cameroonians need to be equipped to do this work, not depend on expatriate missionaries like Val and me. So we entered into this partnership to offer a Bachelor of Arts in Bible translation, and many Cameroonian church leaders have come to the seminary to participate in this training program. They learn about linguistics. I teach linguistics, I teach translation, I teach leadership. They also learn about biblical languages, theology, church history, all the things that you would normally expect they would learn in a seminary. And when they're finished with this 3.5-year Bachelor of Arts program, they're prepared to translate the Bible into their own languages. And 3/4 of the graduates from this program are actively working out in the field, in their own communities, or sometimes in another language, to translate the Bible. So it's proven to be a pretty effective training program to advance Bible translation in that part of the world.
So that's the last 27 years. Tell us what the next coming years have for you as you transition to a new position.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Lord has led us to make a change. We have left Cameroon, and we're going to be working now with Wycliffe Bible Translators and SIL International from the United States. I've been asked to be the SIL International Corporation Secretary. So that means we're going to be working from the SIL headquarters, which is located in Dallas, Texas. And as the Corporation Secretary, I'm going to be like the official record keeper for the organization. SIL has about 5,400 members working in different places around the world in 1,600 language communities, people groups. And I'm going to be the record keeper for all of those people and help the board of directors of SIL to do their work.
So how can we pray for you as you transition from life in Africa to life in Texas?
Well, in a way, America's like a new culture to us, so pray that we would adjust well to this culture. We have a lot of things to learn. A lot of things happen in 30 years. I mean, we've come back for short visits, but we haven't learned a lot. And you can pray for my health. I have high blood pressure and gout and struggling with that a bit, so I want to get that all settled down before I take on any other role. And pray for George as he continues to learn his new role. He's got a lot of things to learn. I want to thank you, too, for your prayers for us over the last, it's been about 30 years that this church has been partners with us. Thank you.
George and Val will be out in the foyer afterwards. So if you've never met them, come up and meet them. If you know them, come up and welcome them back. Let's stand as we pray for them, please. Father, we thank you even for the testimony that we've heard of 27 years of work in the Cameroon and just the fruit of that Val is holding in a translation your word in a language that it was not in before. For the multiplication of translators, and even as we gather this morning and we'll study your word in our language, we know that because of their work and their faithfulness, others can do that in their language as well. And so we thank you for that. And even the future of those that will worship you in their language, we thank you for that. We pray for this transition of theirs, for Val and her health, and we pray that you'll renew her strength, for George and the new job and the importance of it, giving wisdom and insight and a short learning curve, just in this important role in Wycliffe, in SIL. We thank you for that. We pray for the logistics of move from one continent to another, then the purchase of a home and the resettling and finding a church and all that. We just pray, Lord, that that will go smooth and quick and that he can get into the work quickly that you have for him in this next phase. And we thank you for just for your faithfulness to them and their faithfulness to you and the result of people worshiping you and having your word in their language because of it. We thank you for that. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
I'd like to invite you to remain standing. We gather as a community of the baptized. Now, if you were baptized, there's about a 99.9% chance that the person that baptized you said, "I baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit." The baptism isn't just something that happened years ago, one-time thing. Something we live in every day. As we are aware of our need to die to ourselves and to rise again with Christ and allow him to live through us. So that's why we begin our services reminding ourselves of who we gather in the name of. That's very poor grammar. We gather in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, open our lips and our mouths will declare your praise. Let's pray together. O Lord, in your mercy, receive the prayers of your people who call upon you, and grant that we may know and understand what things we ought to do, and also may have grace and power to accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender, suffered and
I believe in the virgin birth. I believe in the saints' communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Yes, I believe.
I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son.
Words from the book that we love, as written in Psalm 69.
Save me, O God, for the waters have come up to my neck. I sink in deep mire where there is no foothold. I have come into deep waters, and the flood sweeps over me. I am weary with my crying. My throat is parched. My eyes grow dim with waiting for my God.
But as for me, my prayer is to you, O Lord. At an acceptable time, O God, in the abundance of your steadfast love, answer me. With your faithful help, rescue me from sinking in the mire. Let me be delivered from my enemies and from the deep waters. Do not let the flood sweep over me, or the deep swallow me up, or the pit close its mouth over me.
Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me. Do not hide your face from your servant, for I am in distress. Make haste to answer me. Draw near to me. Redeem me. Set me free because of my enemies.
You know the insults I receive and my shame and dishonor. My foes are all known to you. Pour out your indignation upon them and let your burning anger overtake them. Let them be blotted out of the book of the living. Let them not be enrolled among the righteous. But I am lowly and in pain. Let your salvation, O God, protect me.
I will praise the name of God with a song. I will magnify him with thanksgiving. Let the oppressed see it and be glad. You who seek God, let your hearts revive. For the Lord hears the needy and does not despise his own that are in bonds.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest, and without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my grace is found is where you
lives to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay. And when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
Father, hear the prayers and the songs of your church as we gather to proclaim what we believe, to remind ourselves what we believe, to say we believe in you, God our Father, that we believe in Christ your Son and his resurrection and therefore our resurrection as well, that we believe in your Spirit that indwells that indwells each of us, and we pray indwells our worship as well, to proclaim what we believe to you, to ourselves, and to the world around us. To proclaim our need for you, not just in a point in time for salvation, for the forgiveness of sins, but then on an ongoing basis in a world that continues to be full of so many troubles and life with so many troubles, to proclaim our need for you on an ongoing basis, to thank you for forgiveness, for the indwelling of your Spirit. And we ask that as we gather together as your church and proclaim these things, that it's an encouragement to each of us and a reminder and a pleasing to you as well. We pray, Lord, for the ongoing ministries that you have within this church, and we pray that you are glorified through them. We think of next weekend, Lord, even as our high school, as our teenagers will go out on retreat and study even the claims of your Son, of the things that he said when he said, I am. We pray, Lord, that that will be a significant time in their life, as even as young adults, young teenagers coming into adulthood, that they're still formulating their beliefs, that this will be a good time for them to grasp the faith as their own, and that they can say that they believe, and then as well, their reliance on you and your Son and your Spirit. We pray that'll be true of them. We pray that it'll be true of us. As your church gathers to worship you, may you be pleased with the things that we say we believe. May you indwell us with your Spirit as we rely and say we need you every hour. We thank you for that. We thank you for your Spirit that indwells our worship. We thank you for your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Well, good morning, Riverwood. I was asking a little boy as he walked through the doors this morning, would you rather have sunshine or snow? He said, snow. I don't know if that describes anybody else here, but at least we're not shoveling 30 inches of it. So anyway, we're glad you're here to worship with us as we study God's Word. And if you've been here the last couple of weeks, you know that we are in the midst of a series in the book of Jonah. Just 1,400 words, very short book, but it's a very powerful message. And so we've been studying this book together. And even though we might think it's just about a big fish and a guy who gets swallowed, there's a lot more there for us to know. And so this series is called On Mission, and what we learned in the first week is that God is on mission. He's a God who loves people, all people, even Ninevites, and he wants all to come to know him. And because he is on mission, he has also put us on mission, because the way he is going to get his message out there is through imperfect people like you and me. And so he uses us in our daily lives as we talk to people and as we interact with others, to be encouraged to tell the story of who Jesus Christ is. And so that is, last week, our heart has to be molded and obedient to have a love for people as well. And so this is the mission and this is the story, and we're going to continue. But along the way, we said we're going to pray this prayer. It's a very simple prayer, and we hopefully are saying it at home when we're reading, and just to be mindful and get into that mindset that every day there are opportunities for us to tell the story. And so if you have a bookmark, hopefully you have one in your Bible, or you have one you can take with you. If you don't, they're out at the counters. But this is that prayer we've been talking about, and we're just going to say it together. I know you've probably been saying it at home, you've been praying it. Let's just say it together as a church. Gracious God, I know that you are always at work around me. Grow my compassion for everyone I'll encounter today. Open my eyes to see opportunities, and give me the courage to speak up when I might shrink back. Remind me often that the results are in your hands. And so we've been praying this prayer for the last couple of weeks, and we also have encouraged you to send in your stories at this email address, jonah@riverwoodchapel.org. And we have gotten a number of stories, and I'm just going to read a couple of them just to encourage you. I had a dream about my aunt. In the dream, she was almost killed by a car that had lost control. And for the first time in her life, it scared her. My aunt is a self-proclaimed hippie who graduated from high school in 1960, hitchhiked from Iowa to California, bought a plane ticket to Hawaii, and has lived there ever since. She loves her Mother Earth and all that the beauty that it has afforded her over the years, thus has never needed God. Because of this, because she is my aunt and elder by 30-some years, I have never thought it my place to question her way of life. However, this dream prompted me to lovingly confront her denial of God and asked her to consider choosing Jesus while she still could. I wrote her a letter explaining that if it were only choosing Christ for this life, I wouldn't have felt the urgency to write her. However, because we all must give account of our choices on earth, and we will live eternally, whether with God in paradise or separated from him in hell, I had to write to her to tell her of my love for her and desire to walk with her in heaven, on beaches far more beautiful than those she had been blessed to walk on this earthly life. I do not know if my Jonah prayer prompted the dream, which prompted the letter, but I am certain that God will honor my words and pray that she will hear and respond. Here's another story. The Lord continued to work this prayer into my life this week. Three clients opened their hurting hearts to me. Two of these women had brothers who were murdered and have seen no justice. The third woman's brother is breathing his last here on earth. I was able to share my hope and the love of our Lord. There were tears and prayers and more tears. I sensed that all three ladies were very much in a different place, in different places with their personal relationship with Christ. One believes in God and Jesus, is unsure of the Holy Spirit, doesn't know if Jesus died for her. The second, like many, think that all good people go to heaven if there is one. And the third is a believer. I don't know if God used me to plant, to sow, or to water, but I trust the results are in his hands. His work is not done. He is an amazing God who will continue, and I will continue to be privileged to serve him. Incredible stories of what God is doing amongst our own people here at Riverwood. And I encourage you, even this week, as you have an encounter and in story, please send it our way at that email address as we encourage one another. The theme of a lot of the stories we get are, I have been pushed way out of my comfort zone, but God is using me in significant ways to tell his story. So be encouraged. Well, if you have your Bible, we're going to be walking continually through Jonah, and we're going to pick up our story in the last verse of chapter 1. And if you were with us last week, you'll know that we left Jonah in a very precarious position, a Bible cliffhanger. Some people came up to me and said, "What's going to happen next to Jonah?" Because the last words out of his mouth were these, "Pick me up and hurl me into the sea." And the mariners who were with him, reluctantly, they tried to row back, but reluctantly, they did exactly that. And so as Jonah hits the water, I am sure he was thinking to himself, it's all over with. And Jonah, well, there's more to the story. And we know that the last verse in chapter 1 reads like this. If you have your Bibles, verse 17, it says, "And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow up Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights." Now let's stop here for a moment. I know that for many skeptics of the Bible and for many who possibly sit here this morning, there's a question in the back of your mind that you just may be a little too embarrassed to say or to ask, but it's one that we just need to just get out there. And it's this question. Did this really happen? Did this Did this large, do we really believe that a large fish, a great fish, as it says here, it really swallowed another human being and he lived in the side of this, of the belly of this great fish for 3 days? And do we really believe this? And what if we don't? Is it really that big of a deal? What if we kind of think this is more in the category of myth? Is it okay to say that's a myth and let's just keep reading the Bible? Interesting question. Does it really matter if we believe this? I think it does. And I'm going to give you a couple of short reasons that I think this is a big deal. You see, Jonah is assumed to be a historical figure. Not only in the book of Jonah, obviously, but in other parts of the scriptures, Jonah is noted as a historical figure. If you go into 2 Kings chapter 14, verse 25, he is listed right there as a historical figure. If you then go into the New Testament, Jesus spoke of Jonah as a historical character. He was someone who, Jesus, he saw his own impending death and burial and resurrection, and he used Jonah as an example of that. And so Jesus saw him as historical, and so we should as well. And so in one sense, it's about being historical, but there's another reason that I think is even probably more important. It's very dangerous to go down the road of picking and choosing what you like out of the Bible. For instance, you get to the parting of the Red Sea. I'm not quite sure if I like that one or not. Doesn't seem very believable. Or you get to Jonah. Man, let's pick and choose. You get to, I'm also going to go into the New Testament. Jesus, he turned water into wine. Do you believe that one? And we pick and choose. And it opens us up to then say, well, if you're picking and choosing, then I'm going to pick and choose. And what if Jesus Christ rising from the dead, what if that was just all myth too? Very dangerous. And so, yes, we believe as a church that Jonah was a real man who was really swallowed by a great fish. To quote the Bible apologist, Ravi Zacharias, he's someone who has gone to different universities and he debates people. There was a little clip on YouTube you can look up where he's at the University of Michigan and somebody asked him the same exact question. Because usually when skeptics come alive about the Bible, Jonah's the one they point to. And he said, what about this Jonah story? And he had a long discussion there, but the last words, last quote, I'll give it to you. He says this, if you think about it, Jonah is small stuff for the one who conquered the grave. It's true. It's true. And so that is why we believe that he was a real man and this really did take place. So anyway, let's continue in with the story to see where it goes from now into the second chapter of Jonah. Let's pick it up. Jonah chapter 2, verse 1. It says this, then Jonah prayed to the Lord, his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All of your waves and your billows passed over me. Then I said, I am driven away from your sight, yet I shall again look upon your holy temple. The waters closed in over me to take my life. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped about my head at the roots of the mountains. I went down to the land whose bars closed upon me forever. One writer points out that in the text that we have seen with Jonah, if you go all the way back to the beginning, the writer has inserted at very strategic points the word down. That this has been a story where Jonah has been incrementally be going down, down, down. In chapter 1, if you just turn back to verse 3, it says, Jonah was on his way. As soon as he went away from the presence of the Lord to get away from him, he went down to Joppa. All right, that doesn't seem too big. Then in verse 5, it says that he was on the boat and he went down to the under part of the ship. And then in verse 15, we see them. He gets tossed overboard, and here he goes, going down once again. And just when you think he couldn't get any further down, notice what it says. It says that he went down to the land where the bars close upon me forever. He goes to the very bottom of the sea. And as Jonah finds himself confined in this fish, he is now at the very bottom of the sea as this fish is swimming around. And what you notice in this first half of this prayer, that going into verse 6, is that it's not just a physical bottom that Jonah has hit. This physical experience, this experience that he has gone through, has led him to an internal bottom as well. And that's really what we get a glimpse of in chapter 2, is what is going on inside of the soul of Jonah. I call it the bottom of the soul. And in these 6 verses, we get a glimpse of what that bottoming out of the soul looks like. And Jonah uses interesting words to describe where his soul is at in the midst of all of this. I'm going to make 2 just general observations. The first one is this, that if you have a study Bible, and hopefully you do, you can, and as we were probably reading this at home this past week, you probably saw that there are lots of cross-references when you get to Jonah chapter 2. And you're like, what is he cross-referencing? What is this prophet of God talking about? Well, all the cross-references, or a lot of them, are in the book of Psalms. And what Jonah is doing is stealing material. He's taking all of the psalms that he had, and he is praying them, he's compiling them and praying them back to God. It's something we see Jesus do. It's something that we should get in the habit of doing as well. Reading the psalms and all of their great ups and downs, the joys of the psalmist, as well as the things he says, why is this happening to me? And Jonah encapsulates all of those psalms and he prays them back. As a quick aside, if you're looking for a resource to help you walk through the psalms and pray them, here's a great one. It's this book that just recently came out. Tim Keller compiled and wrote a daily devotional. It's called The Songs of Jesus. It's a great resource. Check it out. But it'll be a great help for you. All right, that's the first observation, that Jonah has put all this material and he's praying it back. The second observation is this, that he continues to use this watery experience to tell the story of the condition of his soul. And as human beings, we have a strong connection with water and the metaphor of water, and I think we can all relate to it. I'll give you my quick story. I was in college, and a group of us went whitewater rafting on the New River down in West Virginia. Anyone ever done that before? It's a fun experience. And so we get in the raft. There's 6 of us. It's guided. There's a guide in there. He's helping us row. He's telling us, people on the left, row back. People on the right, row forward. Change this, turn that. And it was a fun experience. And as we go through the Class 1, Class 2 rapids, it was a ball. Then we get to the Class 4 rapids. And it was like, oh my goodness. And the tone changed. And he was like, okay, if we actually go off that side of the river, bad things are going to happen. We could flip over, you get sucked under a rock, and it could all be over. And I'm like, oh, gee, this is now important to be listening. So, of course, we get into a position, not the exact position. Our raft then tilts, and somehow I get ejected into the water. And even though it was only a couple of seconds, you feel in those couple of seconds that desperation as the water is just turning you over and you're popping up and down. You feel powerlessness and the frailty of life in that moment. And all of us, I'm sure, have a connection to water as we feel that. And Jonah continues to use those kinds of words to describe what is happening on the inside of him. And notice, if you take a closer look, he says, I am in the belly of Sheol. Now, that's not the name of the fish. The belly of Sheol. Sheol was this place that the ancients, that they associated with death. And it now he talks about the waves are crashing over his head. He uses words like he's in the middle of the floods. There's no land in sight in this storm that just keeps crashing down on top of him. And the word that just comes to the surface out of all of this is that there is a hopelessness. It's over. It's hopeless. But then added to that, out of verse 4, not only is he hopeless, but he says that there is no hope in sight. And he's quite sure, if you notice in verse 4, he is quite sure that the Lord has taken his eye off him altogether. And so to the surface, these words of hopelessness bubble up, but also loneliness. He is by himself. And as Jonah describes it in verse 6, it's as if he's being dragged to a place under the water where the bars are closing in over him that will entrap him there forever. Life's experiences take us to moments internally where we have great hopelessness and loneliness. And sometimes these moments that we all experience are short, but sometimes they're enduring moments that we find ourselves like Jonah in the belly of Sheol. And as a shepherd of this flock, I know that that is the story that we resonate with and many in our own church resonate with. Family upon family, as I look out, I know you have lost someone significant. And whether it was a parent, maybe it was someone who was a spouse, or even a child. In those moments, life gets turned upside down, and you resonate with Jonah too, because it feels as if the waves are scattering you. They're the billows, the waves are crashing in, the white waters turning your life upside down, and you have no idea what's going on. And in those moments, your soul also starts to be dragged away. And there's hopelessness and loneliness. To the family that has been walking with chronic illness for years, and there's a few of them in our congregation, the flood of life has surrounded you. You can't see where the land is even because there's so many doctor's appointments you have to go to. And there's testing and this and that. And it seems like it's never ending. And your soul is being dragged. The couple that has walked through the belly of Sheol in their marriage, the day that they found out that he had an affair with someone at work, talk about being cast into the deep waters and the weeds wrapping around your head. Now what do you do? How can you ever repair that kind of trust when it's broken? Is it even possible? And these are just a few of the stories of the people who sit in the blue chairs here on Sunday mornings. And this is what I know. I know that all of us, to some extent, know these waters. And maybe you haven't been to the very bottom of Sheol, but there's lots of things that have happened in your life that you understand. And in those moments, something inside of you starts suffering as hopelessness and loneliness creep in. And these waters don't just affect those in our church, but they also affect those who you live next door to. Even the people you share a lunch table with, those who are young or old, those who are rich or poor, no matter where you are at in life, the waters and the waves crash in of hopelessness and loneliness. The Bible tells us that it rains on the just as much as it rains on the unjust. And so as the human condition, we understand the difficulties that life presents and how it affects us on the inside. But the next question that comes from these tumultuous waters that we experience is really the most important question. It's two words. Now what? Now what do you do? When you're being dragged underneath and your soul is in the belly of Sheol, where do you turn? Where do you go? When everything has been stripped away, when your strength is gone, when your knowledge has run out, when your control is now out of your control, now where do you go? Jonah isn't done yet. His cry to Yahweh is not complete. Let's keep reading the second half of out of verse 6. We're going to start out with a very short word. It's the word we saw last week, the word but. As something is changing, something's different. Same Hebrew word. In English, you can say but, or now we say yet. Same thing. The author is saying something's changing. Something is changing from the bottom. Let's read it. He says this, yet you brought up, up, up. Different than down, down, down. The author's changing things. Up, up. You brought up my life from the pit. Oh, Lord, my God, when my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you in your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. But I, with the voice of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And the Lord spoke to the fish, and very graphically, it vomited Jonah out upon the dry land. So like us, Jonah was faced with the same question that all humanity faces in the belly of Sheol. Now, what do I do? And for Jonah, there was an answer. When all hope is gone, in the face of loneliness, he realized something. He had Yahweh. God was there. He cries out to him and he remembers, oh yeah, you are with me. You brought up, note the change from down, you brought up my life from the pit. When my life was fainting away, my cry to you was heard. And what Jonah realizes is he's not alone. There is no place that he can go away from the presence of the Lord. And if he was trying to recall different psalms to pray back, one of them might have been Psalm 139. Look at this psalm. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in, here it is again. You notice, Sheol. You, Yahweh, you are there. Even at the bottom of the sea, he is there. God will never leave you nor forsake you. This is the refrain of the scriptures, that we are never alone. And not only are we not alone, but there is also significant things we can latch onto that can give us hope. Notice what he says in verse 8. Those who pay regard to vain idols, if you're going to try to hold on to something in the midst of being turned upside down in the waters, if you're grasping for the things of this world, if you're grasping for the vain idols, they will leave you hopeless. But if you place your hope in Yahweh, he will not disappoint. His steadfast love is sure. It is unending. His love is unrelenting. Even for Ninevites, his love will go to the ends of the earth, and it will always be there. Hope can be found. And what Jonah is realizing is that he's talking about a hope that's with a capital H, hope. It's not a hope that's going to say everything's going to get better in these 50, 60, 70, 80 years that we have right here. All of the things will not be solved right here. But there is a hope that you can latch on to that is about eternity. Salvation belongs to Yahweh, and he offers that as the thing that you can latch onto that will give you hope. And so as I've been studying this passage this week and this thinking about our church and thinking about what is the Lord trying to teach us? What is he trying to say to the people of Riverwood Community Chapel? The first thing I want to say is this. There are some who are sitting here this morning in any of these five sections that I am sure this morning you find yourself in the belly of Sheol. You do. And if we had time, you would tell your story. You'd be like, oh, I am walking through this. And that experience is now having an effect on you internally, and your soul is being dragged to places of loneliness and hopelessness. Let me tell you, there is hope. There is a God who loves you. And he offers something that is so significant that you can be sure of. And he offers that gift of his son, Jesus Christ, that we can latch on to. And if you want to know more about a hope that is sure in the midst of the belly of Sheol, I would love to spend time with you. Or if you want to make an appointment, we can talk more about that. But he is with you. He is with us. Even in our darkest moments, you are not alone. Secondly, I would say this, you know, as we look at this passage, there's lots of these prayers, and as we see Jonah walking through the belly of Sheol, I think about our church as well. And there are so many stories of people who have walked through this same kind of experience, through the difficult things of this life. When I talk about our church to other people, we eventually get around to, I start talking about, you will never imagine the kind of pain some of the people have walked through in our church. Where God has taken a loved one, or God has been repairing this marriage that I thought was destined to be gone. He's repairing, and he's bringing hope. And even in the midst of this chronic illness, I am so encouraged to watch these people walk through this. It's inspiring. It's incredible. And it is your story. And what I see from Jonah 2 is that God uses the belly of Sheol kind of stories to then be used for his kingdom. Because, again, the people outside of our church are walking in that same kind of tumultuous waters where they're being tossed around. And guess what? You might be the one who can say, I've been there. There is hope. There is one you can lean into. And maybe the people that have never heard of God before, and they maybe even blame him, you can be the one to say, no, there is a God who will walk with you. Let me tell you about him. And God will use this community to be the kind of people who will then walk towards people who are distressed. You see, so commonly we see people distressed and hurting. We're like, let's get away from that. I don't know if I can invest. I don't know if I should go towards that. But what Jonah 2 says is that we should be the kinds of people who understand what pain is. We understand the belly of Sheol, and we understand what hope is all about. So now we go towards the people who are hurting, and we whisper things of Yahweh and Jesus Christ and encourage them to give them the same kind of hope that we know they're looking for. You see, the vain idols, they'll forsake them. That's hopeless. But there is something that is sure in the things of God and in his story. And so as I read Jonah 2, my prayer is that he would open up my eyes even this week as we think about telling the story to others. Maybe he's going to open up our eyes to someone who is hurting, someone who's lost all hope, who's no one else cares about them. Maybe his eyes our eyes will be opened to someone like that even this week. God is doing an incredible story, and we have an incredible story to tell as we are on mission with him. Let me pray for us this morning. Dear Lord, we thank you, and we come to your word each week to be challenged. And as we read the words of Jonah, we resonate at a deep level his prayer. We've been to places that are dark and lonely. But for many who are here this morning, they also know the great hope that is found in the gospel and the good news. And we latch onto that, and we're grateful. We'll be forever, eternally grateful. I pray that you would give us eyes to see who needs to hear that this week. Those who are without hope, those who may have been written off, that we can speak hope. Give us those moments this week as your church. Thank you again for your story. We pray these things in your name. Amen.
When the Great Chicago Fire consumed the Windy City in 1871, Horatio Spafford, an attorney heavily invested in real estate, lost a fortune. About that time, his only son, aged 4, succumbed to scarlet fever. Horatio drowned his grief in his work, pouring himself into rebuilding the city, assisting the 100,000 people who had been left homeless. In November of 1873, he decided to take his wife and daughters to Europe. Horatio was close to D.L. Moody and Ira Sankey, and he wanted to visit their evangelistic meetings in England and then enjoy a vacation. When an urgent matter detained Horatio in New York, he decided to send his wife, Anna, and their 4 daughters, Maggie, Tanetta, Annie, and Bessie, on ahead. As he saw them settled into a cabin aboard the luxurious French liner, Via du Havre, an unease filled his mind, and he moved them to a room closer to the bow of the ship. And then he said goodbye, promising to join them soon. During the early hours of November 22nd, 1873, as the ship glided over smooth seas, the passengers were jolted from their bunks. The ship had collided with an iron sailing vessel, and water poured in. The Via du Havre tilted dangerously. Screams, prayers, and oaths merged into a nightmare of unmeasured terror. Passengers clung to posts, tumbled through darkness, and were swept away by powerful currents of an icy ocean. Loved ones fell from each other's grasp and disappeared into foaming blackness. Within 2 hours, the mighty ship vanished beneath the waters. The 226 fatalities included Maggie, Tanetta, Annie, and Bessie. Mrs. Spafford was found nearly unconscious, clinging to a piece of the wreckage. When the 47 survivors landed in Cardiff, Wales, she cabled her husband, "Saved, alone." Horatio immediately booked passage to join his wife. En route on a cold December night, the captain called him aside and said, "I believe we are now passing over the place where the Via du Havre went down." Spafford went to his cabin, but found it hard to sleep. He said to himself, "It is well. The will of God be done." And he later wrote his famous hymn based on those words, "It is well with my soul." I'd like to invite you, if you're able, to stand and sing with us.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows rise,
What a great song. As sorrows will come in and turn us upside down, where do we go? Where do we turn? Can we get to a point where we can say, I have a hope. I know He is with me. It is well with my soul. If you can't, let's talk more. But if you can, then let's rejoice. Let's tell that story. And so as we go, let's say this benediction together. This is a reminder for all of us that we do hard things, the Spirit empowers, and this is all within the God who can do more than we can imagine. And so let's say it together. Now, to Him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to His power is at work within us, to Him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Go in His grace today.